वेलकम एवरीवन टू वीक 29 ऑफ समाचार मंथन द पॉलिटी गवर्नेंस आईआर मॉडर्न हिस्ट्री एंड आर्ट एंड कल्चर रिलेशंस पोर्शंस. सो टुडे वी विल बी डीलिंग विद शिवाजी, छत्रपति शिवाजी महाराज. सो मेनी स्टूडेंट्स आर टेलिंग दैट वी डिड नॉट राइट छत्रपति इन द कमेंट सेक्शन. एक्चुअली द स्पेस इज जनरली नॉट दैट सफिशियंट टू राइट दैट, अदरवाइज वी वुड हैव डेफिनेटली रिटन इट. सो now what how will we approach this topic, because what Indian government is doing is that it is transforming the navy and army symbols and then indigenizing them, doing away with the colonial structures, colonial symbols, basically the colonial legacies. So for that Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj comes into play, that how we are now reforming and restructuring the symbols. But how do we approach this topic, because many of us are scared from medieval history firstly, and then there is this also issue of what is important to remember here, what is not important to remember here, and how do we go into stories, what are the important stories here, and how do we utilize those stories, particularly in our ethics essay portions, GS2, GS3, GS1, across the spectrum, so that we don't feel that we are wasting our time basically. So that is the approach of today, that first of all we look at some important information, very basic information for your prelims, but then immediately we'll go towards stories. But those stories are also important, because then we'll learn how to utilize them, and we'll also connect the geography portions with it, because history without understanding the geography, somehow it becomes fuzzy. And then further we'll look up at further facts which have to be seen, which are more detailed, as in what government is saying as per the Shivaji Maharaj's legacy, the naval legacy, the naval achievements, what have been the naval achievements of Shivaji Maharaj, and so on and so forth. Voice is not clear. Okay, we'll resolve the issue in some time. So basically now I'll just keep the mic like that, so maybe the voice will become clear then. Alright. Okay. So let's see first. So what were we discussing about the important facts? About prelims, little bit first. So now tell me that there was this, you know that there was this Maratha Empire at the peak during Chhatrapati Shivaji's time, and then during the times of Peshwas. We all know that. But are we aware about the administration of these times? What was the administration? What were the ministers called at that point of time? How the administration was run, from whom they inspired this sort of administration. Have you heard of the term called Amatya?
Ministers.
Amatya means minister. As per whom Amatya means minister? What is the meaning of Amatya?
Chanakya, Kautilya, Arthashastra.
Yes. So during the time of Kautilya, Chanakya, basically during the time of Kautilya, Amatya was minister. But here during Shivaji's time, Amatya was one of the ministers. If we think of the Council of Ministers, today we have Council of Ministers. At that point of time also, there were important ministers. But that council was called as Ashtapradhan. That means the eight important people. This is written in the basic books, and generally from administration, a lot of questions are asked in exam, so we have to read that. But is it similar to the Council of Ministers today? Can we equate it in terms of principle at least, that this Council of Ministers helps in making of laws, and this is also eight ministers, so they would have held making of laws. Just drawing a corollary here. Is it so? Can we equate it? I would say no, we can't equate it. Because during that time period, these Ashtapradhan, as the eight important members, used to only implement, execute the policies rather than forming the policies themselves. Today's time period, Council of Ministers helps in legislature, they help in making of laws, and they also help in implementation, but these people only helped in implementation of laws, and basically laws were formulated by Shivaji Maharaj himself on some advisors' recommendations. There was also, you know, interference, or there was also say of the main priest, and so on and so forth. But these were basically important for the implementation part. Are we clear? Now, who are these 8 people? Some important names out of them. So, because this is an Indian, because this is an Indian kingdom, an Indian regional kingdom. So, should there be importance of religion here in this Indian kingdom? Should there be importance of justice here? Should there be importance of a military commander of those times? Because at that point of time, we used to fight wars. The kingdoms were not that stable in medieval India. So, all these will be part of your Ashtapradhan. Like there will be one Senapati, which will be called as Sarenobat. There will be a priest, a chief priest, on whose advice the king would work. He was called as Pandit Rao. Achha, whenever something happens in our life, like in our daily life, what do we say? What happened? Whenever any incident happened, what is the term for incident in Hindi? Ghatna is there. Can we also say Vakya? We also say that ye vakya hua, aisa hua. So that is why whoever who sees some incidents and who works in the shadows, that's a spy. And here Vakya Navis in this Ashtapradhan was someone who was a basically spy of the king. Likewise, compared to Vakya Navis, there was also Sura Navis. Because at that point of time, you have to fight battles, you have to have communications, you have to agree with other kings, sometimes disagree. But basically, you have to have correspondence which should be strong. And for that also, you need an official which was called as Sura Navis. This is the sort of foreign minister. Sort of foreign minister, but basically importance of correspondence. Here in Shivaji's administration and Maratha kingdom, we don't see that much importance of foreign ambassadors. But we can say that yes, for correspondence, there was someone. Now, in this, shouldn't we require something for internal administration also, particularly for revenue? Because if there will be revenue from agricultural lands, then there should be someone to account for. So, for that, for general administration and for revenue, comes the office of Peshwa. Have you heard of this term, Peshwa?
Peshwa Balaji.
Peshwa Balaji Vishwanath, other Peshwas.
Balaji Baba,
Raghunath
Rao.
Raghunath Rao, we have heard, okay.
Savai Mata Rao.
Okay, and have you seen a movie with regard to that?
Bajirao
Mastani. So Bajirao was also one of the Peshwas. So this office later became so important, like a wazir of the king. But in this time period, when the Maratha kingdom had formed, we had Peshwa for generally the importance of administration and financial matters.
But Peshwa vessels were head of vessels or local kings, local rulers, like were they in charge of kingdoms that were smaller in size?
No, I don't think that the Peshwas were in charge of local kingdoms. Generally, this was the policy of Shivaji Maharaj himself, that he used to depend on other kingdoms, on the local kingdoms, but he didn't used to take these local chieftains, have control over revenue and so on and so forth. That means they were there, but the federalization was not allowed that much till a lot of period of time. But then afterwards, they developed the Peshwas, and then from there we had different Peshwa families controlling different places, and from then onwards the Maratha kingdom had been disintegrated. So that is where Peshwa is there. There was one more, you might have heard this term earlier also, Majumdar. There was Majumdar in charge of generally the accounts or the finance parts. There was also one person required for the administration of justice. So we had Nyayadhish also, and so on and so forth. So generally such type of, now in this, because that was the time of medieval India, so we also require some ceremonies, we also require such type of things, right? Where we have births, marriages, where we have different like coronation and so on and so forth. So for such ceremonies also, there was one officer who used to just look after the ceremonies, which was called as Dabir. So these are generally the important names which we need to remember out of the administration. This we covered for prelims. Now we'll go towards the conceptual part, that what basically we want to convey here. So first of all, let us see the context of it. So what is the context basically? That there are some, you know, symbols on the uniform of the Navy personnel. Now in those symbols, we have had the insignia in form of the insignia of Shivaji Maharaj. This octagon-like structure was used as an insignia in the Maratha kingdom, like this part, and that has been now included in those symbols on the uniforms also. Before that, what the government did, we had on every vessel, we generally have a flag denoting the territory, that what is the territory of that vessel, what is the, basically who is the sovereign country over that vessel. And during British times, what we had on the flag is the King George symbol. After independence also, we had this Indian flag here, but the King George symbol somehow continued. Later on, what we did, we had some Satyamev Jayate put here on the same, but still the cross continued. Now this has gone. Now we have had this insignia, again related to Shivaji Maharaj, Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, on the flag here. So this is what we have changed. And in this context, we'll study about Shivaji Maharaj. First of all, his relations with Mughals, and then we'll study further about the naval achievements particularly. Because this is Indian Navy we are talking about. Indian Army also, multiple symbols have been changed and multiple changes we are doing there. But basically in Indian Navy, this seems important. Because at that point of time, if you remember, there was no such substantial power who was having, you know, the Navy, the naval portion there. Otherwise, we wouldn't have been colonized. So that's why we'll look at the Navy portions there. So now in this little bit going into history, what do you know about Shivaji Maharaj's empire? From already, what do you know about it? Let's say this was present in Maharashtra. This is
constant fight. There was a constant cold war fight with Aurangzeb. So and he dressed himself.
There was constant fight with Aurangzeb, and in one of those fights, he just disguised himself in the form of a basket, you know, inside a basket, and then so this story we'll see the importance of it, how do we put it into the GS portions. But apart from that, have you seen the, you know, the coast of Maharashtra, particularly laden with the Western Ghats? Some important cities here, or some important present day geographies, if we can just recall. Have you seen, okay, Mumbai you might have known. Where is Pune? Below? Where is Satara? Have you heard the name of the district called Satara?
Yes.
In what context?
Treaty.
Which treaty?
Ma'am, Anglo-Maratha War.
Anglo-Maratha War. Okay, that we'll discuss some other day. There might have been some treaties because some locations are common.
It was treatment policy. Ma'am, diagnosis.
Okay, we'll see that later. But apart from that, now in this context, what we need to understand here is that there was.
Doctrine of Labs. Was it?
Yes, there was something related to Doctrine of Labs with regard to Satara, but we'll see it some other day. So now, firstly, in this, we need to understand that, okay, there was a kingdom here, basically, but in this, as someone has said, that they were the feudatories, the descendants of Hoysalas. Basically, yes, they were feudatories, but during that point of time, the Sindhudurg was an important location. Yes, we'll come to all those locations here, about the forts being built on the coastal part. So here what was there is that there was this, you know, a Maratha feudatory, and based on some treaty with the kingdom of Bijapur, because medieval time periods we have five kingdoms. Who were the important kingdoms here which we need to know? Was Bijapur in north or Ahmednagar in north?
Bijapur was in south.
Okay, so this was Ahmednagar. But then during this point of time period, we are talking about Maratha, so this will go out of picture. Then we have Bijapur to the south. What was the kingdom around Hyderabad?
Vijayanagar.
This is after Vijayanagar. This is 16th, 17th century. We have Golconda, yes. That is why we have Golgumbad. So basically the interplay of these. So there will be one chieftain here who was creating troubles. You know, so he was then given the land near present day Bangalore, then settled. The son of that same person is called as Shivaji. Left to his guru and his mother. Now this person will grow up, will acquire some lands of some Maratha kings, basically, like some Mores, and will acquire some of the strategic locations gradually.
But the Marathas were a warrior class, right? It wasn't a dynasty as such.
Yes, so Marathas basically were different than the traditional dynasty part. They were a warrior class and they used to live by, generally they used to live on go, as we say, you see, using horses and then going at other places and then acquiring chauth, imposing chauth on them and then living off.
Sardeshmukhi
was internal, chauth was external. That we'll see just after the class ends, important details again. So here what is important is that there was this small ambitious boy, 18, 20 years old, after the death of his guru, his entire jagir of his father went to him of Pune, and then he was around this portions where there are important forts. He was acquiring strategic locations and already existing forts. Now looking at it, because this is the time period of 1650s basically. So who was ruling India at that point of time? Nizam-Shahi dynasty came later. Yes. So Aurangzeb was ruling. Now because Aurangzeb was ruling here, so what he'll observe here basically, looking at these problems in this. Had Aurangzeb or Mughal kingdom come into south at that point of time?
Yes, they were trying.
Because they had also somehow looted some cities related to Mughal Empire, so Aurangzeb is basically suspicious. Now, when he is suspicious and he is looking at other kingdoms also, look, there is Bijapur, look, there is Golconda. So, what he will try to do? He will try to have good relations with Bijapur and then say to it that you keep the Marathas away. And Bijapur was aware of the Maratha strength, unlike Aurangzeb, and that is why they will have, somehow they will have this policy of, you know, having small fights and then agreeing with them, but they were half-hearted attempts, not fully. So this was happening at that point of time. As someone mentioned, guerrilla warfare techniques was used by Marathas. Yes, that was right. After that, what would happen? Strategic locations would be acquired. Now war with Bijapur will happen. Who is the Bijapur person who is very famous here?
Adil Shah.
Have you heard of Povadas in Marathi? How many people are here from Marathas? How many people are from Maharashtra? Yes. Have you heard about Povadas? These are basically, you know, heroic songs and heroic, you know, festivities after the Shivaji Maharaj's, you know, his achievements, his bravery. And one of the most important tales here is about Afzal Khan. So what happened? There was war. Now here is Marathas, here is Bijapur. Bijapur attacked. Now these Marathas, what they do? They use guerrilla technique. That means generally they will not fight head on. But now there is such a big army after them, they will have to fight war. Now when this war will be there, there will be little bit skirmishes, initially defeats. But then what would happen? Afzal Khan would invite Shivaji Maharaj in his camp. Now in this camp, when there will be this meeting, what will happen? Because at that point of time, trickeries were common. You know, people used to betray each other. He had intention, I'll kill Shivaji Maharaj. Shivaji Maharaj already knew that I'll be killed, so let me take a dagger with me and I'll kill this person. Yes. So, what happened? Afzal Khan was killed. what was the impact of this? Why are we discussing it? Because this is just about, you know, you can practice it anywhere about practicing rationality and just observing and, you know, predicting the threats and then taking action rather than escaping. So this is somewhere we can put in essay and so on and so forth. But beyond this, what was the impact and history of this incident as such? What would happen when this news was spread to Maratha and to Bijapur? The Deccan ulcer of Aurangzeb. Yes, Aurangzeb can be called as the Deccan ulcer.
Deccan ulcer?
Yeah, it is that incident of Aurangzeb and Maratha's.
Yes. So what will the impact of such an incident where an important minister of Bijapur kingdom is being killed by Shivaji Maharaj? What will the impact here in the Maratha kingdom and in Bijapur? His bravery would be then realized across the kingdom and he became a very popular leader. Who will have the most problem when Shivaji Maharaj will become a popular leader?
Aurangzeb.
What will Aurangzeb do? He will release another of his persons, Shaista Khan here. Now again, this is an important figure in history because he is often asked. So Shaista Khan then was sent to have war with the Marathas. Again, he will also, now in the northern parts of the Maratha kingdom. Now in the northern parts, they will again have passes and Marathas will initially have defeats. But then what will Shivaji Maharaj do is that, what if I kill the commander himself so that the armies run helter-skelter and then we'll defeat them. So what did he do? He just went into the harem of Shaista Khan and then he tried to kill him in night. Yes. There was a topic of essay about the visionary leader. This is the perfect example for introduction. Yes, that how visionary leaders think. They just predict the threats already and then they take action on them. So that is there. Now in this, when he killed this, or when he tried to kill, he was injured, Shaista Khan was injured and he had to run away. Now this was a great blot on the Mughals themselves, that one of their governors, he was injured, losing his finger and so on and so forth, and then running away, and then all his forces were just, you know, helter-skelter running from the workplace, and then the Marathas were after them. And so that's why what Aurangzeb will do, he'll just transfer these, Shaista Khan to northeast, to some other part of India, without giving any audience to this person. But then he'll rely on Jai Singh now. Jai Singh, who is Jai Singh? What is the contribution of Jai Singh in history?
He's the
Raja Jai Singh. He was an able commander here, hello? So what he'll do? He'll first of all look at all the situation. And because he is not biased really in terms of religion also, he looked that, okay, Marathas have certain powers here and Marathas cannot be easily defeated. That is why what he will do, okay, let me have word with Shivaji Maharaj. Now Shivaji Maharaj was going on acquiring multiple ports. Till that point of time, he had acquired around more than 35 ports. And who was helping here, who helped build this army? He had acquired very strategic locations here in terms of the altitude. Because look, this is the altitude, high altitude regions here. If you acquire the strategic locations here, then it will be easy to invade into these areas and into the coastal areas also. So he had, firstly he had captured in his initial times, Javli. That is why I had asked about Satara. Because from here, he had acquired some forces. So have you heard of the term called Mawali?
Mawali.
Mawali, as we say, generally Gunda hai, Mawali hai, that term. So, sort of. So there were these Mawali people here, the tribes, whom Shivaji Maharaj had taken with them. And these were the forces who were with them in all these invasions. Why we are discussing that? Because you can see the origin of the words here. So how the words evolve, and they have been, such tribes have been important during Anglo-Maratha wars also. So sometimes these terms can be asked. So basically these were the disciplined forces now. So Shivaji Maharaj had confidence that okay, he is having the forces, he had already occupied Satara and had the support of Mawalis here, and then he had the fort of Purandhar here around Pune. Again, as we have also, UPSC has also asked questions about Panipat. So someday they can also ask about Purandhar. Why? Because yes, it's not Mawali, it's not. Yes, in different places it is mentioned differently. So basic idea is that now what will happen here? So why Purandhar is important on lines of Panipat? Because multiple, again, battles have happened, multiple treaties have happened at this place. So there was this fort here where Shivaji knew that okay, his family is also safe. So now he can fight a war even if Jai Singh comes after him. Now Jai Singh and Shivaji will fight a war. What will happen when Jai Singh will fight war with Shivaji Maharaj? Shivaji Maharaj will get defeated. Why? Because his family was lying there and they were around to capture this fort also. And along with that, there were serious reverses, because these are the forces who fight generally guerrilla warfare. Not necessarily they can stand every disciplined army. Now what will Jai Singh do? Jai Singh will tell him that you come to agreement. You have treaty of Purandhar with me, and you have a treaty with me. What you have to do is that you just have to surrender 23 of the 35 forts you have acquired. You have to give around 5 lakh honas to Mughals every year, as is generally the norm in medieval India. And in exchange, you can take some of the territories and some of the revenues from the Bijapuri kingdom. That means somehow having a wedge between the Marathas and the Bijapuri kingdom, so that they keep on fighting against each other, and then the Mughals have achieved their objectives. Now Aurangzeb, again being little arrogant, so to, even today people of Maratha including me take pride. Yes, so that's nice, that's very good. So now what happened here? Aurangzeb, again not that visionary basically, and he was not that caring, and not that very careful of the Maratha threat. He thought that okay, these are some petty bhumiyas or landholders. He was not aware with the problem. So then Shivaji Maharaj was called into a court, and then we know that he was embarrassed by little situations like not giving the audience, proper audience to Shivaji Maharaj, or giving the same rank of Mansab as was given to his son Chambaji. So basically Shivaji left the court, and when he left the court, this created a trauma here into the court here. This created a situation, because no incident like that had happened in history of the Mughal court earlier. So then Shivaji Maharaj was placed in detention, and Jai Singh was asked basically, what do you do with them? Now Jai Singh told that look, these are very pride people, these are very proud people, and you need to understand their psychology. If you give them the same rank as you would give them off to their son, of course they will be feeling that they have no value, and they have great value in the local empires because they have acquired important forts. They sometimes loot Surat also, a very important location of trade right since Mughal times, right since medieval times. Then they have acquired important coastal areas here, like we have the location of Jinji here, just south of Mumbai. Again, this will come into play later on, as we'll see. So important locations, important forts have been built up here, like Sindhudurg, as was mentioned earlier. Khanderi fort was developed on the island. Khanderi, you might have heard in news, the term related to some submarines were in news sometimes back, Kalwari, Khanderi, Karanj, Gala, Vagir, Vagashi. That we'll say later on. So the connector. Yes, the building up of submarines, Scorpion class submarines basically, that we'll say later on. Basically what was there was that the legacy here he was not able to understand. So Aurangzeb did not pay attention. Then Shivaji Maharaj escaped from there, and then afterwards what did he do? He kept silent for two years, that okay, I'll not take any action now. Afterwards what he'll do? He'll acquire all the ports which he had lost to Mughals. during the battle with Jai Singh. He acquired all those ports, and during that point of time, after that, in 1674, I think, he had coronated himself, and from there onwards, he was called as Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. And from here onwards, we had Ashtapradhan also, and other such administrative things. Coming to the taxes part, what was the taxes part here? So, the internal areas were taxed at 10% rate, Sir Deshmukhi. Out of that, the external areas where these forces used to raid, had guerrilla warfare into the Mughal territory, into the Bijapuri territory, they used to ask around 1/4 of their land revenue, of their overall revenue, of their kingdoms as protection. That will not raid you again and again. You give us 1/4 of your revenue as chauth. That is why it is called as chauth. In fact, chauth has been one of the reasons for some major wars. Because if you take 1/4 of the revenues from the neighboring kingdoms, of course they would not support you in times of need. Like there was the case during the third battle of Panipat, that these kingdoms did not support it, Maratha kingdom, because of the presence of chauth. So that is there. Now we'll see the naval achievements here basically. Those are more important. Why? Because the government had released a paper sometimes back, staticjob.gov.in. If you want to see, you can see it. Although we'll cover the most of its content. So basically the idea is that they are emphasizing on the naval achievements of Maratha, and this can be compared with the Cholas also, and this can be a potential question. So here what was Shivaji Maharaj's idea is that he used to say that these European kingdoms, he already knew that these European kingdoms, British, Portuguese, Dutch, they had started coming at that point of time. And when they had started coming at that point of time, he had told them, as these people are revenue extractors, they'll come to your place, they'll acquire, and then they'll never leave. So we'll have to have navy for trade also. They are near the coast, so they'll develop some ships. And these ships are of different categories. Do we have to remember the names? Yes, because these are mentioned in the official document. So we'll have to remember it, like Gurab class or Galbat class or Machwa class ships or Bathor class ships. Pal, basically the Bengal, the Pal kingdom of Bengal. Some of the ships were there also in the Bay of Bengal. So that style was called as Pala class ships. If we see the pictures of these ships, so these are basically Machwa, open-ended, run by many people, so not that useful into warfare. But if we see the other ships, like these are Gurab class ships, having three masts and different you know structures here. Basically they have cannons also here, if you see. So because they are trying to replicate the Portuguese and the other kingdoms here, you know, the other colonial powers here, because initially they had employed the Europeans only to learn these type of things. And although they used to develop these ships from the local wood rather than from the from the foreign materials. So this was there, and this was Galban class ship, basically a smaller ship but having sufficient weaponry here and to help into mobile sort of warfare, to be little mobile in the sea and to be able to tackle large colonial powers which are there into the sea. So this is there. Now when this was developed, after that there was first attack of the, you know, there was first attack from the side of the Marathas into a territory called Basur into Karnataka. First raid, from there their journey developed. They had developed around 30-40 ships comfortably, and they were running into the the areas here into the sea. They also had to trade with the Middle Eastern countries, so they were already sending the materials with the naval trade into the Middle Eastern countries, and this is how things were going on. But then afterwards what happened, as we saw, there was this Shivaji Maharaj, and then the Shivaji Maharaj again occupying lot of territories. But finally Shivaji Maharaj, after a final campaign into Bijapur, had died in 1680. Now when he had died, his son Shambhaji came up. Mughals under Aurangzeb were already angry. Now what they'll do? in a war, they'll find Sambhaji and they'll kill him. Now, will this defeat the power of Marathas? Will the killing of the son defeat the power of the Marathas here? Basically, this will not be a huge breakthrough. Why? Because after the killing, what will happen here to all the Maratha Sardars who were divided till now? They will again unite. If they will again unite, what will happen? They will keep on raiding into the Mughal territories. As we have seen here, the Aurangzeb, having lack of a strategic vision, he'll try to attack here into Bijapur, into other territories further south, trying to stretch their supply lines of communication and supply lines, and the Marathas will keep on attacking those lines. When supply lines are thin, you can easily attack, and you can, you know, ask for chauth, and mostly all the zamindars will secretly give you chauth, have secret agreements with you, and you will keep on looting and plundering him. And what will it will lead to? It will lead to entire weakening of the Mughal Empire. Now, when this will lead to entire weakening of the Mughal Empire, now what's the idea here basically? What will happen to the naval power then? What will happen to all those forts you have built up? Sindhudurg, Vijayadurg, Suvarnadurg, Padmadurg, all these Maratha forts were there. And what basically will lead to here afterwards? To the Maratha kingdom and to the Mughal Empire. What this will lead to in terms of Mughal Empire? It was a minor, yes, killing of Shahaji Bhosle was a minor setback for Marathas, who now formed the confederation and marched, not exactly marched in Delhi, but yes, they keep on looting. Now it led to weakening of Mughal Empire. In the last days of Aurangzeb, Aurangzeb died in 1707, died desperately that now my entire kingdom is in tatters and the Marathas have destroyed it and so on and so forth. Now what did we need to? Now, after Shahaji Bhosle was killed, his younger brother Rajaram came upon the throne, and when Rajaram came upon, the same developments continued into the naval power. Multiple other forts were also developed, so that was there. Khanderi, have you heard of the term called Kolba?
Kolaba.
Where?
Mumbai,
Kolaba beach.
So, Nariman Point pass.
Yes, so Nariman Point is near to it. So this was also developed at that point of time. Khanderi is an island just off the coast of Mumbai. So this was also developed, and further the developments continued under Tarabai also, who was the widow of Rajaram, and there was struggle of Tarabai with the son of Shahaji Bhosle, who was later on released by Mughals after Aurangzeb. So not getting into all those factual details, basically they were later also continued, and in that context we have to remember one personality, Kanhoji Angle. Why we have to remember him? Because he was the major pioneer then after Shivaji Maharaj, who had taken all the naval achievements here and all the naval expeditions. Like it happens rarely that any indigenous kingdom is ever able to defeat the Europeans. But during that point of time in naval warfare, there was capture of English vessels also, there were victory over the Dutch also, and there were victories over the Siddhis also. Have you seen in news, there are these tribes of Karnataka of African origin who pierce hooks into their body? Hakki Bikki tribe, you know. So there are these tribes of African origin into these places, and they had basically at that point of time, when during the time of Mughal times and medieval times, in Bijapur and Ahmednagar, we had these Ethiopian origin slaves coming into these kingdoms, African origin slaves from Ethiopia and other parts, and these slaves then used to be incorporated into the kingdoms there, apart from tribes also coming in. So they had an important role here, and there was one such tribe which remains in news called the Siddhi tribe here. If this is Maharashtra, the southern part of it, you know, adjacent to Karnataka, near the Konkan coast, there these Siddhis live, and they also used to fight with the Marathas. Like we have seen this Khanderi just off the coast of Mumbai. Just there is one sister island of Khanderi called Underi. Now what happened? Khanderi was acquired by Marathas during Shivaji Maharaj's last years. Underi was acquired by Siddhis. So this is how their battle with Siddhis used to continue, and they used to continue this warfare among themselves. So they had to fight Siddhis also apart from Bijapur and apart from the Mughals here. So basically this was the contribution here related to multiple forts and the continuation of the the achievements here, which later on declined. From this point onwards, there was duality of authority of Prime Minister, who was subordinate to and used to serve in the king. So yes, so during the time of Tassil, as we have seen, there was this one woman, Tarabai, and there was son of Shahji Bhosle, Sambhaji Bhosle. Now among both of them, there was Tassil, and at that point of time, there was one Peshwa. We might have heard his name. It is mentioned in books also, Peshwa Balajinath. So he supported the son of Sambhaji, and then I think his name was Shahu. So now from here onwards, the position of Peshwa had become like a wazir, and from here onwards the authority of Peshwa became important during the Maratha time period. So what we have to focus on here, remembering all these locations little bit, and remembering the naval achievements, trying to remember the personality, the name here, and apart from that, little bit about history, two incidents which will help you remember all the history. The Shivaji's encounters with Afzal Khan and Shaista Khan. So that will also help us remember. You can later on connect the killing of Afzal Khan with the Shivaji festivals, which were there at the time of Bal Gangadhar Tilak during modern history. So those were utilized later on. So that you can remember, and this topic can be covered that way. Any doubts, any comments? There is indeed factual details are more, but I can't do anything because the government had released a document and they had all these factual details there.
Do we need to remember all those battles and...
No, you don't have to remember all the battles. Rather, what you can remember is the term Khanderi. Looking at the images, these images, Gurab and the Gulban class vessels, that part, the Pala class vessels, that means they had relations with Bengal also, Pala kingdom, or they were replicating the same style. Although at that point of time, Pala kingdom was not there, it had already vanished. So little bit about the forts, just trying to remember that, okay, all these Durg and forts are related to the names of the forts, that we can remember somehow. So that way it can be covered. Even if you remember these two names, I think that would be sufficient. Rest we can guess in the exam. Guesswork also plays a role. So that would be sufficient, I think. Alright. So this is similar, the same things which we have mentioned, just that their philosophy was Jalamev Yasya Balamev Tasya. That means whoever rules the sea will have the ultimate power. That's there. Okay, alright, so I'll switch off the live, and then we'll discuss the other topics of this week, all the topics related to polity, IR, art and culture, governance, modern history, and so online students also, we'll meet next week, preferably on Saturday this week only. So thank you. How far can we agree with the statement, contrary to popular opinion, that British contributed to modernity? It were Marathas who were precursors to modernity. Modernity has multiple meanings. Firstly, the meaning related to the achievements with respect to navy, the achievements with respect to military, the administration, and the mentality, mindset wise. So I would say that really the British, we can't say that the British were precursors of modernity in India, because the British just wanted an Indian elite who were British in mind. So they just were trying to westernize us, but Indians themselves, being exposed to Western education, had modernized themselves. I wouldn't call Marathas as the precursors to modernity, because for modernity you need a mindset which is completely modern, and here the mindset was traditional only, related to society. And furthermore, in administration also, most of the administration was taken inspired from Malikamba's achievements here, that we'll discuss someday, and Ethiopian slave, African slave coming to not Delhi Sultanate, this Bahmani kingdom, and then their later on remnants. Malikamba is related to that, I think related to Ahmednagar or Bijapur, one of them. But basically the administration was also taken over by mostly similar to the other, so not such really achievements, but achievements in terms of military were there still, because in modernity multiple aspects are there, so I wouldn't call it as completely modern or precursor to modernity. So that falls short of modernity, but yes, nevertheless significant achievements, and that's why we still remember Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. There are multiple locations, even the terminus in Mumbai after Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj. So that's the importance, and we'll switch off the live now. So yes, thank you so much. इतनी छोटी क्लास होती